And we return to the major developments at the court today with a look at the legal implications for the same-sex marriage rulings. For that, we're joined by Mary Bonauto, special counsel for the group Gay and Lesbian Advocates and Defenders. She's litigated cases against the Defense of Marriage Act. And Austin Nimocks, senior counsel for the Alliance Defending Freedom, a conservative Christian legal organization. He was co-counsel for the supporters of Proposition 8 this year. And welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
Mary Bonauto, let me start with you. Taken together, how much of an endorsement of gay marriage do you read into these decisions today?
I read some, and I say that because with respect to DOMA, we are now replacing a system that officially disrespected the legal marriages of same-sex couples for over 1,000 federal purposes and replacing it with federal respect for those marriages. So that's obviously an important endorsement. The opinion couldn't have been clearer that this law saying that only marriages of same-sex couples would be disrespected demeaned the relationships that the states had meant to confer dignity and respect, and DOMA was taking that away and hurting people. And it does hurt people when they can't get a family policy of health insurance or file their taxes jointly, but it also hurts much more in the way that the court really picked up in terms of saying this was really a way of saying gay people and their families are unworthy.
Same question to you. I want to get this general proposition, and then we'll walk through some of the details. How broad a reading do you make of today?
I think if any endorsement can be taken from today's decisions, it's an endorsement of the right of the states to continue to debate and decide the question of marriage. I mean, striking down DOMA, the Supreme Court said that we need to defer to the states that have traditionally had the province here. And so what we know is that this issue is going to continue to be debated and decided by people at the state level with their state representatives and their state provisions for dealing with these questions. And so the question now goes from the Supreme Court back to the people in their various
states.
But
on DOMA itself, you're not seeing the kind of sweeping decision that Mary Bonauto is saying? You're saying this just sends it to states again?
Oh, the Supreme Court clearly struck down DOMA, and the reason that the Supreme Court said they're striking it down is because the federal government has traditionally deferred to the states. And so if a state declares somebody as being married, the federal government needs to recognize that. So it really re-centralizes power for the definition of marriage to the states, and that's where we see it going back.
Where do you think it leaves things?
I have to say, I think that's a slight overreading here, because the court noted that states traditionally say if somebody's married or not. And it was extremely unusual. In fact, it's the first time ever in history that the federal government has stepped in and wiped out a class of marriages. That's what was unusual. But the court couldn't have been clearer that while states regulate marriage, they're subject to the Constitution. And that's why I think this issue will be back at the court, probably in short order. Because, you know, if there's a fundamental right to marry and the court has said so 14 times, the question remains, why is it that that fundamental freedom is being denied to committed, loving, gay and lesbian couples?
We heard from Gwen and Marcia talking about the fact that the court did not rule on whether there is a constitutional right to gay marriage. Was that a disappointment? Did you want it to go that far?
Well, in the DOMA situation, that was specifically not at issue.
Right.
It was about DOMA itself.
Right.
And then with respect to the Proposition 8 issue, you know, if the court had gone in that direction, so be it. But I think the handwriting was on the wall that the state itself had not appealed in California and the proper parties were not in front of the court. So to me, it's a great victory that marriage is being restored to California.
How do you read the Proposition 8 decision, one you were very much part of?
Oh, we're disappointed that the Supreme Court determined that we didn't have standing to defend Proposition 8. But ultimately, our opponents didn't file that lawsuit to prove that we don't have standing. They filed the lawsuit in order to impose 50 state same-sex marriage solution on the entire country. And ultimately, they were unsuccessful. Then the Ninth Circuit's opinion striking down Proposition 8 was vacated and sends it back to California. And we're very happy about that, that the Supreme Court did not act with a heavy hand. And that's what we've been saying all along. The Supreme Court does not need to act with a heavy hand here. It needs to take a more muted approach and not try to resolve this for the entire country.
Is it clear in your mind where this leaves things in California? Does it, in fact, open the door for gay marriages to go forward?
Yeah, it's really not clear at all at this juncture exactly what type of legal circumstance remains in California. And there's a 25-day window that will be considered in terms of what happens now, what goes forward, because there is no appellate court decision holding Proposition 8 unconstitutional. And so it's a legitimate question. We're still looking at the opinions. Other legal scholars are looking at the opinions, and we'll see coming forward what may happen with all that.
Have you had a chance to look at that?
Yeah, my sense is that marriage is going to happen statewide in California. Mm-hmm. The registrar of California was a defendant in that case and is directed to control the county officials who control marriage licenses. So I have been through some of this where people try to restrict a ruling and so on, but I suspect we're going to have marriage in California in a little over a month.
Are you suggesting that there will be legal, there will be some kind of legal action in the next 28 days or months?
It's certainly possible. Mm-hmm. What we don't have right now is a lot of clarity with regard to it. And so I know that, you know, the two big Supreme Court opinions with all the things I said is a lot to digest in a few hours. But I think in the days coming, there will be more clarity as far as that's concerned.
What about in states? I just want to think about where things go next. What about in states that just have civil union right now? Is there anything out of today's action that might have an impact for those states?
Modestly, yes.
Modestly.
For the most part, the federal government has a system that's based on marriage. Mm-hmm. That's the primary relationship that it respects, although it does also respect some other relationships. And there are some programs that, again, when you delve down into the details where the statutes are clear that if you have certain obligations to one another, certain rights under state law, you would be protected. So there will be some...
Where the legal reasoning from these cases might apply in those cases.
Yes.
Do you see that possibility?
I don't really see that as a possibility, just because the Proposition 8 decision from the district court was so specific as to the state of California, and every state has come about its laws in completely different ways. If some states have marriage laws that were enacted by the legislature, others voted on by the citizenry, and so I don't see a lot of transportable precedent as far as that's concerned. But what we can agree on is that the states are going to have the right to continue to deal with marriage through their democratic process. And I think that's the most important takeaway.
Well, so is that where... I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yes, I mean, that is all true. And it's a debate that obviously has been... Our country's been engaged in mm-hmm. at every level, and that's a terrific thing. At the same time, the court is clear that every state law is, of course, subject to our constitutional guarantees. That's why, you know, Virginia's anti-miscegenation law had to fall when it did. Is ultimately, the court is the one to say if a state's enacting its marriage law has drawn the wrong line...
Well, so where do you see the fight going next? Is it a lot of legal battles? Are they political battles? Is it still a mix of both, as we've seen for many years?
I think it's a mix of both. But I do have to say that I think this issue will return to the court. I think you're going to have states where this debate continues. I think you're going to have some states going back to the ballot to repeal some of those hastily enacted constitutional bans. Mm-hmm. I think you're going to have state court decisions, and there are a number of federal court cases already pending.
When you say return to the court, do you mean the Supreme Court? Because that's what we were just talking about.
That court, yes.
That court, yeah.
Yes.
What do you think about the prospects of that?
Well, I do agree with Mary in that the process is going to continue, probably some courtroom of public opinion and whatnot. And we can agree on, I think, that the marriage debate will continue in this country. The Supreme Court didn't settle it, nor did it really try to settle it in its entirety. And so there's going to be a mix of different things happening. But Americans who are, as Justice Scalia noted today, deeply invested in this issue are going to continue to voice their opinions.
All right. Austin Nimocks, Mary Bonauto, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
And online, just what are the benefits that legally married gay couples will now be able to receive? We have a list of some of those on our homepage. And we have more reaction from California from the NewsHour's Spencer Michaels coverage at San Francisco City Hall this morning.